on October. And I want to introduce Dr. Brad West. He's a good friend of mine. He's a wonderful being, but also on top of it, he's a really good neuropractic doctor in Los Gatos. So he offers mostly holistic prime care with specialization in intravenous therapies and injections, therapeutic fasting, clinical nutrition, bioidentical hormones, thyroid, digestion, and immune challenges. Now, on top of all this, Dr. Brad, for the past 4 years, he has been part of the Ecopolitan Skin Clinic removal, removing session lesions in a natural, non-surgical way. And he will tell you a lot about this, how it is possible that you can have all your lesions removed with no problems, with no surgery, no scars, and so on. So that's really can be a big eye opener, also when it comes down to skin cancer. Right now, we do have in the Bay Area 6 doctors doing this on 10 different locations. And they, you can find them all under, it's on this flyer I handed you out, ecopolitanskinclinics.com. They, all those doctors use a method developed by Dr. Tel Oren, and he worked on this since over 25 years. He's an Israeli doctor. And he's really doing good work. So we started to train also other doctors, and Dr. Brad is one of them. What I also would like to tell you, that the Ecopolitan Skin Clinics, they support the poorest children in Nepal. It is Dr. Taloran's passion to take care of orphanages and children in Nepal. And that's why he worked so hard and has started to build up clinics all over the US, so all those clinics would support actually his mission. So just be aware, in case you want to get rid of them all, it means you're donating also to Nepal, which is a nice thing. If later, after this talk or so, you would love to have a brief inspection of any kind of skin lesions you may have, you can come to our booth and it will be free. You only pay if you get treated. So, but if you have any questions or whatever, just please come by. And our booth is in the very big room there in the left corner, and you come in from the front. You will recognize it because we have the on our banners the same pictures. And with this, I like to welcome Dr. Okay. Brad West.
Thanks, Anna. Okay, thank you. Thanks, everybody. Okay, a nice turnout today. We try to come here every year. And I know Dr. T speaks often on all wide variety of subjects. Is everybody, or how many people, show of hands, are familiar with Dr. T and his work, Dr. Tel Oren, or Ecopolitan? Okay, so only a few today.
Speaker?
Yeah, can you hear me okay? Nope, and I don't think there's a speaker, right?
No, there's
not. So, okay.
You have to speak loud.
Okay. Well, I don't speak loud, so we'll just keep working on that. Just keep raising a hand if you can't hear me. So today's topic is one that's near and dear to my heart about skin treatments and cancer prevention. And today we're focusing on skin cancers, which is by far the most common cancer. I think it's double all the other cancers put together. And I like to clarify right away that there's only 3 types of skin cancers. And 2 are very benign, which means not dangerous, and 1 is very dangerous. So does anybody know the name of the really dangerous one?
Melanoma.
Melanoma, yes. That's represented in your card in the upper left corner. It's hard to tell on this picture without closer exam of an active melanoma versus a pre-melanoma, but this is generally what they look like and you hear about. Often, if you're paying attention, and to differentiate, to really drill down into it, the melanomas are black often very dark, if they're either black or brown, but very dark and flat. And that's what this is representing, as well as often they're asymmetrical. So we have the A, B, C, D, E's in medicine and dermatology to talk about the borders and the color, et cetera. And that's what we're really seeing here is asymmetrical shape, the dark color. Now you notice it's flat. A lot of people have moles and they run to the dermatologist, and that's usually good to get checked, although I don't really agree most of the time with their treatments. And that's where naturopathic medicine and holistic treatments are often different. So one thing that I love about Dr. T's work and the Ecopolitan charity is that it's a very non-invasive treatment. So you can find out all about that at the booth, and I'll talk a little bit about it hopefully today, how the treatment actually works. So the other two cancers, squamous cell carcinoma and basal cell carcinoma. And those generally are not considered dangerous because they're very surface. The basal layer is the deepest layer of your epidermis, the top layer of your skin, which is very thin. So just from that description alone, we know that it's not going into the dermis or the subcutaneous fat or the muscle very, very frequently. It grows out and laterally a lot of times. So that one is represented here, I think, on the bottom center, the ulcerated carcinoma. They often look pearly like that. This one's very old. It's been around. This person had that removed by us perfectly. It came out great. Took about 2 months to heal because it's quite large. He was told he needed to have skin grafts and a major surgery for about 3 years, and he just refused. And Dr. T treated him, came out perfectly. So I think there's before and afters at the booth as well. But that's a basal cell carcinoma. They can go deep, but it's more unusual. And what I like about this treatment and Dr. T's teachings is it's a different paradigm, kind of like a lot of us here with natural medicine or, you know, plant-based diets, vegetarianism, et cetera. We're on a little bit of a different, if not quite a bit different, paradigm. So the paradigm that I am now a part of with the skin treatments is, number one, is diet, and we'll get into that, how that affects the risk for cancers, particularly skin cancers. But we know it's really all cancers. And I kind of lost that thought. Well, let me come back. If that comes back, I want to go on to squamous cell carcinoma. So basal cell, we're talking about melanoma. That's the black flat ones represented here, the most dangerous. They can kill you fairly quickly because they spread so rapidly. So that's why it's worth to get any new mole checked quite frequently, any race, color, et cetera. Everybody's at risk. We can flush down and drill down into different risk categories based on those categories, but generally that one is, all the three skin cancers happen to everybody, every color, every race, and both sexes fairly equally. So that's melanoma, basal cell I talked a little bit about. It tends to look like this one, but it can also look like a pimple. So if you have a pimple, often on the nose, can be forehead, could be, you know, arms. These are sun exposed areas. And the melanomas usually aren't. So if you have a black freckle that's getting larger on your foot, the feet really don't freckle. So some people will have moles, or they'll have a little, maybe a freckle, but it's very unusual. So any dark flat spots like freckles or moles on your feet, especially between your toes or under the feet, but even the top of the foot going a little bit up into the ankle, you'll notice you really don't tan or freckle there. Very unusual. So those are more risky. Melanomas will also show up on the glutes, you know, anywhere around the hips, non-sun areas in the scalp. That's debatable if that's non-sun exposed or not. But so that's a difference with the melanoma. Again, no sun exposures, and the basal cells, which is sun-exposed areas. Squamous cell is the third one. It's very similar to basal cell. It can look almost identical. And the only way you can tell a difference is a biopsy. And another part of the paradigm shift here is that really don't think there's strong evidence for biopsying these type of lesions. It's known that melanomas are dangerous and they spread, so it makes sense to not biopsy a melanoma and just remove the whole thing. And you see people with giant aggressive surgeries to remove them, and sometimes that's warranted. However, with our different kind of paradigm again here is to treat them usually through Dr. T, who's an MD and a chiropractor, but treat them first. And depending on how it looks, we can often save people from the really invasive Mohs type surgeries. And I think Mohs surgery today is currently practiced incorrectly compared to how Dr. Moe, Frederick Moe, developed it over 50 years ago. So that's a procedure where they shave it and they take it into the other room and they look at it under a microscope. And they keep shaving it and bringing it back and until they find that there's no cancer cells. And then it's a clean margin. Well, the beauty of Dr. T's treatment is that it was developed in dermatology actually about 80 years ago. And it's an acid that he's played with and got just right about 25 years ago to go right into the bottom of the epidermis, that basal layer. So it gets about 95 plus percentage of lesions. That could be a freckle, that could be a mole, could be a skin cancer. Some of those skin cancers, particularly melanoma, can dive down, right? They can have deeper roots. They often come back up, and that's when you notice, oh, this is looking bad or dangerous or strange. So that treatment will almost always get that. And what we're doing is we're peeling off a layer. And usually it's the whole thing, because almost all lesions go in down into the epidermis, not into the dermis. The treatments that we usually get in conventional medicine now is burning or freezing, right, or cutting, and that goes way beyond the epidermis. And when you get into the dermis, that's where you get pitting, scarring, etc. And if it saves your life, we can justify that, right? But I think with this treatment, it really isn't justified because there's a better treatment, and it's been around for 80 years. And it's only reason I can think that it's not on every, you know, doctor's shelf is that it's low tech. It's a little acid in a toothpick. But it works incredible. And we have 25 years worth of proof and before and afters. I've probably had 5 squamous cells removed from my forehead, 2 moles from each cheek, probably 20 or 30 treatments on myself alone, and thousands of lesions that I've treated. So I know it works, I know it works fantastic, and it works for all these lesions that are listed here.
Is it multiple treatments or multiple?
So usually it, like I was saying, it's a good question. So the question is how, you know, one treatment, and it's usually one because it gets right into the bottom of the epidermis, and 95 plus or more lesions don't go into the dermis. So with one treatment, we get it. If there was a deeper lesion, it goes into the dermis or beyond, well, the dermis becomes the epidermis, right? So as it heals, it takes anywhere from a week to maybe 2 months if it's a really large and far from your heart, low circulation area, that lesion will push up, and we'll see it the root at the top, and we just treat that. And it's usually not urgent. If it is, you know, have you come in more frequent, or we send you to your dermatologist? But that's a bit how that works. So to recap here, the 3 skin cancers: melanoma, the dangerous one; the black flat one; squamous cell and basal cell carcinoma. Okay. So the way that that's a little bit about how we treat them, but the way they develop and the way we can prevent them are the same. And it has to do with, well, what do you think is the number one cause? Skin cancers.
Sun.
The common answer, what else besides?
Hereditary.
So hereditary, sun, diet. The biggest is diet. Now, I think there's pretty good evidence mounting on this. You usually won't see it, you know, on the front page. But we know that the skin is protected by antioxidants, right? And by tanning. So what do? In modern times, we don't tan, we avoid the sun, and we don't eat very many antioxidants. Most Americans don't eat a plant-based diet or a diet that's really rich and fresh, organic, mostly uncooked, highly colored fruits and vegetables and plants. Those are loaded with antioxidants, which protect your skin. An interesting thing that I noticed, being a you know, in the medical field for about 20 years is when the raw food movement really got going in the late 90s with David Wolf and Gabriel Cousins and on and on. We've seen a lot of people go raw, sometimes 6 months, sometimes a year, some of them 30 years, like Victor Skolvinskis, right? And we see a dramatic drop in sun damage. And these guys, I don't know if you've ever seen David Wolf, he's always tan, they're always in the sun, and a lot of his followers, right, a lot of us probably here, they're not getting, and we're not getting the skin damage when we change their diet that radically. And I don't think it has to be 100% raw vegan diet, but the idea here is it's really hard to study without big bucks all these little nuances, but the idea here is pretty clear. The more sun you get, it's not the more skin cancers you get, especially if you have, and particularly if you have high antioxidant diet. So there's, and that is the polyphenols and the colored, you know, fruits and vegetables. There are others, even fish oil, omega-3s, that's an antioxidant. Your body uses all sorts of things for antioxidants. But on the oil challenge, and this is what I learned directly from Dr. T, again, who started the charity here and the skin treatments, Dr. T does some fantastic talks, and if you have a chance, you can see him on all over YouTube and his Ecopolitan website. He has thousands of videos. There's one called, my favorite is Dr. T in 3 minutes on thousands of, well, at least hundreds of subjects, including rancid fats. So rancid fats are likely the smoking gun, if there is one. It's a big, big piece of this. And so, what we see is the average, you know, American, the standard American diet is really rich in rancid fats because we're cooking meat, we're cooking vegetables, we're cooking everything. And there's fat in vegetables, right? There's fat in all, just about all foods. And that will, when it's heated over a certain temperature, there's different smoke points, there's different denaturing points. We usually use the word denature when we're talking about proteins, and we use rancid when we're talking about fats. And you can tell when a fat is rancid. The human nose turns out to be more sensitive than any equipment at picking up rancid fats. And you know when you go to Trader Joe's or somewhere and you get a bag of nuts and it's in a bag and it looks good and you get home and it doesn't smell very good. This has been sitting in the warehouse. You can pick that up better than the finest fish oil industry equipment for omegas and the rancidity. They use some chemicals, anistidine, and peroxide and anistidine are the chemicals we can measure if a fat is rancid and how long it's been rancid. But the human nose is the best. And so when we, bringing this, you know, back to the point is when we cook fats or when they go rancid, it doesn't actually have to be cooked. It could be sun-dried. That could potentially make a fat go rancid. The classic example is flax, but so is chia. There's a lot of seeds and oils that are very sensitive, especially the omega-3s. They're the most fragile. And those are the ones that we have the hardest time getting, but they're very fragile. And so are the other polyunsaturated fats, omega-6s, that are in vegetable oils. But omega-3s are much more sensitive, and you can smell them. It smells like bad fish. Even flax will smell like that. Again, chia and hemp. So if we dehydrate these in a raw food, vegetarian, vegan type setting, they can still go rancid. So smell them, taste them. If it's bitter, that's another sign that it's rancid. Anybody who does supplements like fish oil, and if you taste it, Costco fish oil, you bite the capsule and you taste the liquid, it tastes really fishy and bitter. If you get a high quality one, it tastes a little fishy, but not bitter. And you won't burp it up. So that's another sign, is belching it up. And I'm really trying to emphasize this point, so a little more educated on it, because when we are what we eat, right? So when we eat these rancid fats, and it could be a super healthy salad with some old walnuts. And those fats, we are what we eat, they get absorbed into our system. They go into the subcutaneous fat layer, which is right under our dermis. So epidermis, where most lesions are, dermis, and then the subcutaneous fat. That's made up of the fats we eat, and your body will use whatever it can. So if we're eating rancid fats, we're gonna have rancid fats in our under our skin. And when the sun hits those fats, the DNA is already damaged and challenged in the fat, or it's rancid, it's oxidized, and the sun will cause more damage. So what we see is, I call it the French fry and sun phenomena. So if you're eating bad fats and you're getting a lot of sun, like I did in my most of my teens, surfing and eating French fries and all that kind of stuff, fish tacos, you know, you name it, tons of sunbathing, and that damages the skin. That combo is the problem. Okay, so you can protect yourself with tanning and with darker skin, but we're still seeing problems if you're doing the French fry and sun, you know, combo. So, and it doesn't have to be French fries, you know, we pick on French fries, but it could be, you know, a raw flax cracker. So we are seeing some problems in the raw vegan movement with this now, that people are getting so creative and doing so many processed foods. And I think that's the gist of it here, is it comes down to, we really have to follow nature. How are we designed? We're designed to eat off the land like every other animal. You never see deers with pots and pans or any other animals cooking anything ever. And not that I'm a raw foodist myself anymore, but I can see the beauty in following our anthropology, our history, our evolution, which is somehow debatable now. But from my bias, it looks like we are really aquatic apes. I follow more of the aquatic ape theory, that we evolved near the ocean with lots of seafoods, and using the ocean as protection makes perfect sense to me, because we stand on two legs, which makes us very slow. We're very slow, very weak compared to all other animals. So our advantage is to go into the water. We can swim, we can wade, we have long hair, baby can hold onto the hair. Women have breasts year round. No other animals have that, so they float. There's all kinds of reasons, but the one for me is this subcutaneous fat. Our subcutaneous fat is very different than all other animals, even primates, even monkeys, gorillas. They don't have the same, they have fat around their organs. We have fat right under our skin. And only other animals, there's a few others that have that. One's a reptile. Does anybody want to guess? Alligators? I don't know about them. Hippopotamus. So they're water creatures, right? And makes me think, so are we. Because last time I saw, I'm not fast enough to catch a fish. And if I did catch one, there's no way I could really bite it. We don't have the strength. We don't have the claws or the fangs. We don't even have the digestive tract. Everything points to me towards aquatic ape evolution. Which doesn't mean we couldn't eat some mollusks, or I don't think we'd eat dead fish because it smells terrible. But some seaweed, you know, maybe some mussels, things like that. But generally, we're eating off the land. So seaweed, roots, vegetables, berries, etc. And that doesn't have rancid fats. And if it does, you can smell it. And if you're living off the land and all your ancestors did, you're probably pretty attuned at smelling what you eat first. So that's a big part of my talk and this issue, is that it's not just the sun. Of course, the sun plays a role, but the sun, like anything that can harm you, can make you stronger. So we can build a tan, and that's the melanin cells, right? The melanin cells cause the tanning, but that's also where the melanomas come from, right? But we don't see melanomas on sun-exposed areas, very rare. So, you know, what's going on here? And what a big piece of it is that we're now understanding is that melanomas are caused by a lack of sun. Okay, melanomas, the most dangerous skin cancer, is caused by a lack of sun. See this picture? The skin is very white. Not a coincidence. People who avoid sun are low in what? Vitamin D, right? We all know that now. I like to brag that naturopathic medicine has been talking about all these issues since its inception over 100 years ago, and particularly vitamin D, and checking vitamin D, and checking vitamin D3, and that was hypocrisy. And you couldn't take vitamin D over 500, it's fat soluble, you're gonna get, you know, poisoning, and not true. Now guess who's doing MDs, and everyone else is testing vitamin D3, and not D2, but D3, and they're giving you 100,000 IU shots, which in itself, overboard now, causing problems with our bones and vitamin K and vitamin A, because it's nature, and there is a balance there. So you're seeing more and more formulas with vitamin D3 and K2. So it's complicated, but it doesn't have to be complicated if we follow nature. And to me, that means eating a whole food, plant-based diet. And depending on your own addictions, preferences, physiology, and just time period in your life, you know, we change. Just because you did great as a vegetarian when you were a teenager, you might not forever. I think of the classic kind of thin hippie, right? Like I was. Not probably the best person to have a vegan diet unless they do it really well and understand nutrition and physiology. And who does as a teenager? You need to see, read good books and see good doctors. And always check yourself, meaning don't buy into one theory and sacrifice your health. It's possible to be wrong. You could be thriving on a vegan diet, but you're really getting low on B12 and you're causing neurological damage to your body, or iron, because you're a menstruating female. And sometimes we have to take shortcuts or make changes. The other example I like to use is Bill Clinton. He went on a year vegan diet. It was really famous about 10 years ago, and I think he's still doing a lot of it. But he is the classic big belly, red face, you know, eating too many calories, too many bad foods and meats. And when he went on a year vegan diet, he lost tons of weight. He looks great, and that is a treatment. That was a great treatment for him. It might not be for the thin menstruating female teenager. It might if they're able to supplement with iron and some other things. I don't believe protein is, as long as we're on the nutrition topic, I think protein is greatly overemphasized, and so does Dr. T, that we eat way too much protein. And not just, protein doesn't mean meat. That's one of the big misconceptions, is where do you get your protein, right? Where do you get your calcium? We've all heard that. First of all, calcium is abundant in all plants. Just about all foods. It's in potato chips. Calcium is the least problematic mineral for most people. Now if you're talking zinc and magnesium and selenium and chromium, those are minerals that it's really much harder to get. We need to focus on those, but we, you know, the mainstream doesn't. So the protein part, I like to remind people that most meat, even the leanest meat, chicken, etc., is more fat than protein. Most of the time it's more fat than protein. 30% fat, 25% protein, somewhere in there. So protein can be vegetable proteins, like the powders, I really mean. When we eat a high protein-based diet, we see adrenals get affected, affects the cortisol levels, it's hard to digest, or has ammonia and other metabolites that are problematic. So I talk about using fiber, I think is what we're missing here. And I think most people here get that. When you eat a plant-based diet, you're getting a lot of fiber, okay? And then that's preventing cancers, and it's mainly colon cancer, but it slows our blood sugar down. So if we're not slowing our blood sugar down, we get diabetes and, you know, ADD and hypoglycemia and problems. We can feel it, most of us, although the body's really good at compensating, right? So if we use protein to can do the same thing, right? It's like protein is like a slow burning log on a fire. So your blood sugar stays stable longer. And that feels good. So people crave and they get addicted to their protein when they really should be using fiber from plants gathered in the wild. I think we're really gathetarians more than anything else. So it's what we can gather. And the whole paleo movement, I think Dr. T has a 6-hour talk kind of debunking the paleo phenomena. That we're not just there wasn't just cavemen who ate meat all the time. That was a very short period of time and evolution, and there was millions of generations before that to get to the point where it even looked like we do now, that didn't eat meat. We're not designed, like we said, the aquatic ape theory, right? And you know, I don't mean to throw people under the bus with that at all, but just trying to stimulate thought. You know, let's figure this out, because there's a lot of sick people out there, and there's a lot of misinformation. And what I'm saying could be misinformation. Well, what I believe it to be true in my experience, but check in with yourself and keep reading and keep trying things. So let's see, I think we talked about the three kinds of skin cancers and how we can treat them, what causes them, right? And then, so sun and french fries, the rancid fats, not enough antioxidants to protect them, because those antioxidants will protect those cells. You're getting bombarded from the sun and radiation and Wi-Fi and 10,000 other things. Those, I also like to remind people that wearing a shirt that's a trauma. A lot of people have moles along their neck and their armpits or bra line or belt line. Wherever you get a lot of friction, you can see skin tags. And those are on here too. So I think I want to talk about some of the other lesions now. But those, any kind of trauma is a problem because it increases the risks of a freckle, mole, or skin lesions. Anything on your skin, usually it's moles, and they get bumped, and then they get sun, and then you're picking at them or you're putting things on them. That's all trauma. And you know, 5, 10, even 500 times, maybe probably no big deal. But 501 maybe triggers the DNA change, and you happen to be sick that week or have a sunburn or whatever, and that DNA becomes cancerous. And usually it's slow growing, and most of like the ones I had were from 20 years ago, and they slowly evolve, and you don't really see them until you feel them. And so, see, maybe I should discuss that. So how to find them? So the squamous cell and the basal cell, the non-problematic ones, unless you biopsy them. If you biopsy them, you cause inflammation, which is a precursor to cancer, and they can leak into your bloodstream. And there's nothing more dangerous than squamous cell carcinoma cells in your bloodstream. They can stick kind of anywhere, and 10 years later you die of a uterine cancer, and nobody connects the dots. Well, Dr. T has, and I think he's right on about that. And he's treated over 100,000 people. And so be careful with that. You know, I don't, okay, I think I should address that now too, is the biopsy issue. So how do you deal with that? I think I like to think about it in this way. Why do we need to know? Why do we need to know what it is? Does anybody feel strongly like I need to know what that lesion is? What if it's a freckle? What if it's a skin cancer? Does it really matter? I mean, it matters on some level, but it doesn't matter if you get rid of it, right? And that's the beauty of this treatment. It gets rid of everything. It doesn't matter if it's a freckle or a skin cancer. It gets rid of it. Maybe 100 times it needs a retreatment, or I'll have to refer somebody. Actually, I've never had to yet, because we just keep looking at it every few weeks or months if it's a dangerous looking lesion. These are very rare. So we don't really need to biopsy and know what it is. It would be nice to know, hey, Dr. T got rid of that, you know, basal cell, or I put hemp oil on it and it went away. A lot of people will put a lot of things on lesions and they will come and go, hydrogen peroxide, frankincense, all kinds of things we can put on. And what I've seen now in the many years of doing this is that they come back. And I don't know if that's another form of irritation. Probably not. I mean, it seems like it's helping, but they almost always come back. And the treatment that we use is an acid that causes a scab, and it goes away. And when it heals, it doesn't scar because it doesn't go too deep. And it heals. So, sorry, I got distracted there. We were talking about the biopsies, and where else was I leading with that? Squamous cells. Shoot, this flew out of my head. It's the problem when you're public speaking. Well,
why do you need to know?
How much do treatments cost?
Hold that thought. What was that?
You're talking about why do you need to know, why do you need to biopsy
it? Yeah, thank you. So let me finish that thought. Well, maybe I did, but basically you don't need to know. Just if you treat it, it goes away. It'd be nice to know, but we don't need to know because it's gone. And that's the difference with conventional medicine is, hey, let's watch and wait. But the problem with that is then it's risking your life because it could be, you forget about it, or it gets too progressed. Or that it instills or sets you up for a possible invasive procedure at a future time. Now they've got to really cut it out and you have a huge scar. I've seen people with, you know, with giant chunks out of their scalp. I mean, it could really be devastating. You see a lot of people walking around, they might look like they have a little bit of a scar, a crooked nose, or those are Mohs surgeries. Often that looks like it's a type of plastic surgery to often piece these people back together. The skin is very thin. You don't have a lot of room to be scalpeling around your cartilage in your nose or your lips or your chest or your eyes. So I always say start with this type of treatment. And the way the treatment works, again, I talked about that. It's a free exam. I don't want this to be a, you know, advertising marketing piece for us, but we do a free exam, and then we can look anywhere on your body, and I mean anywhere. We've treated every square inch of the human body, and that includes inside of lips, under eyelids, places where we can't really go with a scalpel or a freezing or lasers. And it dries so instantaneously that it doesn't like get into your eye. We can do children, see a child on here. It does burn a little bit because it is an acid, but it will, it dries pretty instantly.
Can you talk a little bit about the relationship between early sun worshiping and later skin?
Yes, and then yours was.
Also, what's the toxic amount of vitamin D3?
Okay. So I'll address that first. The toxic amount of vitamin D3, really unknown. It depends on so many factors. If you take it all at once, and you can affect your vitamin, your calcium absorption in your intestines. Generally, we do blood tests, and we'll see if it's between where it's at. Most people are in the 20s or 30s. The range goes up to 100 in the US. It goes up to 200 in Canada. The last study I saw on vitamin D about 5 years ago, where they looked at natives, on average we're around 150. So I feel like if a native walking around and around the equator is at 150, that's probably fine for most of us.
They say, like, you know, there are people that take, they make these kinds that say to have 5,000 in each tablet, like you take in the morning and in the afternoon with your calcium and K2, mm-hmm. then you're getting like maybe 1,000 a day at D3. What would happen if you had two?
Yeah, I think we should address this while we're on it too, because it's a big part of the discussion, which was the sun, right? And the sun is where we should get our vitamin D, and we should be sunbathing about 20 minutes on 50% of our skin or more for the average kind of Caucasian skin, right? And so you don't want to burn, but you will be preventing melanoma. So I think, do you want to be kind of old and wrinkly and leathery skin and have no cancer, or do you want to have really nice, you know, perfect skin and have maybe not live that long? And there's a correlation there. So get some sun. 5 minutes in the summer sun is about 1,000 to 2,000 IUs in most skin types. So when someone says, you're taking 10,000, that's huge. It's huge compared to the FDA, but I think the FDA is designed for a squirrel. You know, it's, yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, so the sunscreen part, it will. Most UVA and B sunscreens are now combo UVA and B, and they will block your vitamin D. So you don't get sunburn, but you also don't get vitamin D, so your cancer risk goes up. And so there is really no happy medium there, I think, other than slow tanning and, you know, not burning ever, and maybe the slightest pink. If you have darker skin, you have to, you know, adjust, and you know your own body, and you have to feel that. But you want to get fairly dark. And
you not go between 10 and 2 when the sun is the strongest and still get the vitamin D and not
get. I think it's really the direct opposite, you know, to go between 10 and 2. But be careful, you know, build up. Because it depends on a lot of factors, your skin color, the latitude of the where you are on the planet, the season. I think you could, yeah, you could go first. So I want to answer some of the other questions. But yeah, I think the point is build up and then get some sun, and you need at least 50% of your body, so that might be a bathing suit for 20 minutes, and that might be 10 minutes on each side to not burn. If you really don't want to do that, you don't want to have darker skin, or you don't want to have, even though it's beautiful, I don't know why you wouldn't, but if you didn't want to have darker skin, it's possible to maybe protect your face, because that gets enough ambient sunlight anyway, and tan the rest of your body. Maybe pick your favorite spot and tan your 1 foot or something, but no. We need to tan all over. You can avoid the face. Don't use sunscreen, in my opinion, because unless you know I'm gonna be on a boat, I'm gonna get really burnt, I don't have any shade, then maybe I would use a zinc, titanium type. But shade is your friend there. The skin cancer rates have gone up in my generation, and I'm a Generation Xer. We're the first generation to have sunscreen our whole lives, from babies up. We have the highest skin cancer rates, so 45 to 55 years old. So skin sunscreen does not protect you. In fact, it makes your melanoma risk worse. It does protect you against some of the squamous cell we talked about, and those will feel very dry. You'll feel them on the nose. It'll be a red spot usually, or a dry spot that never goes. You put lotion on, it doesn't go away, or keeps coming and going. Eventually it stays. That's a skin cancer, very likely. Or it's on here, I think we have actinic keratosis. That's like a pre-skin cancer. And it looks red and flaky. Okay, so those are very easily prevented by the things we talked about. They're very easily treated by the things we talked about, if we have to. So to bring that kind of full circle into the talk here was to not fear cancer. So if you're young enough to do some of the things we talked about, great. If you're not, great. We can treat it and it goes to a charity.
I have a quick question.
Yeah,
how would you treat an area, for example, because it sounds like you guys encourage doing the treatment prior to checking or knowing if it's dangerous or not. But if you had a problem, someone has a lot of dark spots on the shoulder or a woman on her decolleté, how would you create a treatment like that with your if your special asset would you, how large of an area could you cover?
So we don't treat, the question is, you know, how large of an area, what if there's a lot of black spots? Well, most people have a lot of brown spots and those are benign. We still recommend removing anything with melanin in it because it's potential to get melanoma or anything elevated because of the trauma we talked about. But the décolletage area, you know, it gets, you can see with age, usually by age 40, women will have a permanent, if they wear V-necks, they'll have a permanent darkening there. It's very thin, there's not a lot of fat there. So you have to be very careful treating that. We don't treat bigger than about a dime size at a time, and most lesions are smaller than that. If it's larger, we've had giant birthmarks. We've done a chunk at a time. Birthmarks are a little different. They take numerous treatments because they're so deep, but it does work fantastic for that. And then if someone has multiple brown spots like this one on here, the middle far left seborrheic keratosis, that's probably the most common mole, especially with age. You see, you know, really old folks with, you know, big ones on their forehead or their arms or anywhere. And some people form more of those than others. But most people get some of those with age, and they are not dangerous. They look like this stuck-on piece of gum, or they're elevated. They are kind of ugly. We don't like them. You can pick them off. They'll grow back. They'll bleed a little bit. But they come off much easier than a regular mole. You just can't get off. They are so on there, right? So we do treat those. They take a lot of liquid. They usually come off in one treatment, where other treatments, they'll come back. And the nice thing about this treatment is since it works so well, we can guarantee it. So that's one of my nemesis, the seborrheic keratosis, because they're so big that I have to use a lot of liquid. It takes, instead of a 10-second treatment, it takes 5 minutes sometimes. And to get through we call it the horny layer. It's the horny layer of the skin, and they're very oily. And so they're very resistant. And if you leave even a tiny bit on the side, they'll come back sometimes, think of a coral reef, they'll start to come back. And we treat those, for any of our treatments, we have a lifetime guarantee. We will retreat anything that comes back.
You said that sunscreen makes melanoma risk worse, so you wouldn't use sunscreen if you...
It blocks your vitamin D, and plus you're putting carcinogenic chemicals on your skin. Almost all sunscreens have carcinogenic chemicals in them.
Well, there's all the kinds of, they have at the health food stores, Green Goddess or Sunlight.
There's some better ones, but
there's various kinds, yeah. You know, that have natural ingredients.
They almost always still have parabens or preservatives in them. So try to move away from the sunscreen. Again, keep one around if you have to, because you can't avoid the sun. But use a shirt, use a hat, use some shade, use a tan, build up. Okay?
Yeah. What about putting any kind of lotions or anything on your skin, coconut oil?
Yeah, kind of I say our take, because I'm really speaking for Dr. T a lot too here, and he's been my mentor, if you can't tell with this. He talks about not putting on coconut oil or olive oil. It kind of feels nice in your skin. It actually has some SPF naturally. I think olive oil is about 4. I think coconut might be 2. So you can stay out 4 times longer, but it also accelerates because it's an oil. So there's a balance there. But our take on it is any moisturizers on the skin make your skin dry, because now it doesn't have to moisturize itself. So it starts to dry out, and then you're stuck. You're always having to put it on. So to break that cycle, one is not bathe as much. Let your natural oil stay on the skin. That's another way to prevent skin cancers and problems. I always say wash the pits and parts, you know, and leave the rest of your skin alone. It has bacteria on it that protect you from the environment, all sorts of things. So that's, you know, the discussion about antimicrobial and antibacterial, you know, soaps, etc. So leave your skin alone. It knows what to do. Okay. I guess we're on Q&A, so we've got about, 5-10 minutes. Any burning questions?
Yeah, I've heard that as you age, your skin loses its ability to absorb to make vitamin D. Is that true?
Sorry, say that again?
As you age, your skin loses its ability to absorb vitamin D from your skin.
Yeah, you know, that's, I haven't looked deep into that, but that's a great question. I think it would make perfect sense. Do you comment about that?
No, the question he asked was about the delayed sun exposure, early sun worship, and its correlation with later.
Oh yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't get back to you on that.
Melanoma or...
So, woman in the back, I don't know about that. It makes perfect sense, especially if we have a lifetime of putting stuff on our skin. I think with more wrinkles and more protection, you're going to have a harder time absorbing D. And I think of the old shriveled up, you know, beautiful Italian women who just have, they're so dark and they're in the sun every day. That's probably how we're really designed to do. Get more and more sun and more wrinkles. And, you know, you're supposed to be, I think, more and more honored by the tribe for your wisdom, right? We tend to not do that in modern times. But so the question on the early sun worshiping, pretty hard to protect against that. I think you know, damage is done to a certain extent. Luckily, like I said, we can treat it. We can treat it non-invasively, non-surgically, and we can guarantee it. But I think this, you know, the more you can change your diet to the high plant-based, the more you can do the right things that we could have been doing back then, the longer those will take to come out, the longer the, you know, we'll see a lot of on the scalp and men or ears, forehead, you know, anywhere on the face, or driving arm is pretty classic, or hands. You know, most of those are just kind of age spots or actinic keratosis, the pre-sun damage. But eventually they cross over, and the only way you can tell is if they're actually active cancers is if you biopsy them. But with enough practice and time, you can tell by feeling them. But just because it became cancerous doesn't mean I have to get it off my body. They're so slow growing. They can be quite ugly and large and get bloody like this guy. But that's usually decades. So I think if you treat him early, like if he would have treated that one as a tiny little spot, it might have still popped up around it, because you don't just burn one spot on your forehead, right? You burn the whole thing. So a lot of times I'll treat one spot, and a few years later another one will pop up, and the person will say, oh, it came back, and it's not. It's the next spot, and I can tell, because it's usually a little bit lighter colored skin where we've treated. And the money goes to a charity, so I try not to give out free retreatments all the time, but I still do, because I'm not going to argue with you if you really feel like it's a spot that needs to be retreated. It's pretty easy to do. So I think, yeah, cleaning up that diet, getting tons of antioxidants, maybe adding supplemental antioxidants that you're, you know, if you're just not a big fruit and vegetable eater, or you can't get organics, or I think juicing is another great way to get a lot of sugar, but you can get a really high amount of antioxidants if you're juicing carrots, beets, you know, organic, et cetera, kale. Now, there's a lot of issues with all of these. You know, kale has a lot of goitrogenic potential. That hasn't really fleshed out, but we're worried about that in thyroid sometimes. Spinach has a lot of oxalates, and almost everybody I test has high oxalates. And that usually means there's a candida or a yeast overgrowth, maybe from too much juice. You know, so there's a lot of thought, and I think most of us here are already, you know, well down that path. So we have to trust our own knowledge and our own resources, and keep, you know, go to your naturopathic doctor, or go to Dr. Google and find someone you can trust, or a trusted website or article.
Do you ever treat melanoma with this acid?
I'm not supposed to. I'm a naturopathic doctor, so only MDs in California can treat cancer. I can support cancer. If it's a pre-melanoma, I can treat it. I feel really comfortable, more than most dermatologists actually at treating them because it's so non-invasive. But I will refer people if I need to. Dr. T is an MD, so he can treat melanomas if they're active or we suspect. But we don't know because we don't biopsy them. And it's really a different paradigm. We don't like to refer people. And I know Dr. T is a very brave man. He treats, I've seen everything under the sun treated and treated effectively. There's been no lawsuits in 25 years and over 100,000 treatments. So I feel really, you know, good there. But again, since I'm a naturopathic doctor, that's a 4-year medical trained equivalent to an MD, but you know, we're not in the club, so we have some political restrictions like treating cancer, okay.
So if there's suntan lotion that doesn't have parabens and doesn't have preservatives, like Badger, and there's some other brand like Goddess, Green Goddess or something,
yeah.
And they have like one kind is mineral based, one has zinc, and one has other minerals, like Hawaiian.
We generally use zinc or titanium oxide, I think, as the best active ingredient. But I've still yet to find one, even Badger, even California Sun, even the better brands that don't have problematic chemicals in them to stabilize it.
What are the problematic chemicals?
Look on deadlysunscreens.com. Deadly sunscreens.
Debbie?
But deadly.
Deadlysunscreens.com.
I don't want to talk any more about it because my philosophy is don't use sunscreens. The whole theory is wrong. Why do I want to block the sun? I don't want to block the sun.
Okay.
Unless I'm going to burn and then I'm going to wear a hat or use shade.
Okay,
it's not a freebie. Even your face, I'll let my sun, my body get damaged, but I want to protect my beautiful face.
Uh-huh.
That's a problem.
Okay.
That's a problem because you're putting toxic chemicals on your skin, and you're also not letting sun in, which we're designed to have. So, you know, ease into it. Get a little bit of a base tan on your face so that you don't burn so easily. I was out waiting in Raw Daddy's line, and you know, it's super hot, and I'm standing like this, and it's like a 20-minute wait, and I'm over in the sun, and I love the sun. I usually would just do this for hours. But, you know, I'm older now, and I've had some removed, and I can feel it, and it's just, you know, it's too intense, and I'm thinking, did I have French fries this week? You know, so, you know, do this. And I feel like, yeah, I'm pretty fair-skinned, even though I've done a ton of sunning in my life. So I got about 5 minutes, and then, it took 15 more, so I went and moved, and then I came back. So, you know, you got to gauge it yourself, but it's that kind of thinking, okay? I think we got time for a few more questions, but not many.
The highest amount is D.
Oh, you're over your limit.
Yeah, the relationship between skin pigmentation, Eastern European, let's say, versus Western European, the correlation with skin cancer.
Yeah, so the question is about the correlation with skin cancers and color of skin, you know, East versus West, et cetera. And, you know, I haven't seen drilled down into those numbers beyond med school, which to me was almost 20 years ago. So what I remember and what I see in practice is that it is much higher in the fair skin. But it just depends on the type of lesion. You'll see on here this darker skin pigmented person here, top, second down, the hyperpigmentation. So different types of skin do different things. So the darker skinned folks will often get hyperpigmentation spots. So when I treat a lesion, for instance, a mole on a face and it comes off, it might be a little pink on a light complexion person for a few weeks to months before it totally blends in. On a darker person, it could potentially be darker. It could, so we have to be a little more careful with darker skin folks often. But it really depends on the size and the location. They rarely get hyperpigmentation like that. That is more of a disease process. So I like to talk about Morgan Freeman. You know, you see all the little dots, right? And a lot of African Americans or darker skin will get that on the face or around the armpits. And that's often, and lots of other people do too. We see diabetics. It's often a sign of blood sugar instability or hormone instability. So if you start to get a lot of skin tags, then we know that something's going on with your blood sugar. You're maybe pre-diabetic or diabetic and don't know it. Okay, so those are other issues. Yeah.
On the skin tag topic, do you recommend skin tags be removed if you have them from birth?
On skin tags?
Uh-huh.
Or birthmarks?
Skin tags.
So skin tags aren't really congenital. You're not born with them. You could have moles that look like skin tags, but generally those are always moles. And yeah, we do remove moles. Moles can be, they look like a little tag. You know, little moles can have all kinds of different looks, but generally they're very fleshy. It might be regular skin color. They can be really small or big. They look like skin, but skin tags are different. They develop, and they're almost always around highly friction areas, or armpits is very common, or neck. Okay, and you'll see maybe hundreds to thousands sometimes. And we treat those. We treat them all, and they come off quite well. I want to say before we break, see, what was it? I think we covered... There was something else that was bugging me here. I know what it was. I just wanted to say that Dr. T is the founder. He's going to be here tomorrow. He's usually here both days, but he's working out of state. He'll be in, I think, tonight or tomorrow morning. He's doing a big talk in the auditorium tomorrow. I don't think he's talking about this subject. He's probably talked about it so much. He's so brilliant. He has a photographic memory. He can talk about any subject. And I listen with a keen medical kind of scientific mind, and I've never caught him in any exaggeration or being wrong on any fact. He's just incredible. So his name is Adiel Tel Oren, and he's an American Israeli guy, so he has a cute accent, and he is just so sharp. If you can, go to his lecture tomorrow or talk to him at the booth. I think he'll be at the booth. We have a little booth set up where we can actually look at your lesions and treat them on the spot. And average lesion is anywhere from $20 to $50. Some are up to 150 if it's very large, and but that's generally how the pricing goes. And that money goes towards his NepaliChildren.org charity. And he takes people on treks to Nepal twice a year. So he's, I think next week's coming up October and March to visit where the money goes, the orphanages and the schools way up in the Himalayas. He has an elephant up there that they like. They say it's his, but I don't think it's really his, you know, but they have a pet elephant. All kinds, it's just fascinating. So, and it's the cheapest way to go to Nepal. If you ever want to go on a trip with a doctor and see the real Nepal, I think it's $4,000 or $5,000 for the whole trip for about 10 days in Nepal. So, last question.
Yeah, have you ever treated lipomas?
Lipomas. Yeah, again, Dr. T, I think, has treated everything, but it depends on how much time we have. Lipomas are fatty tumors. You often see them in the arms. They're very large. They can be on the back. They're very deep. They're under the epidermis, so we can't go under the epidermis. You really have to have them surgically removed. That said, I've seen Dr. T just apply the liquid over and over and over and over and get them to pop. But then you have to go in and you have to get rid of the some of the other cells, sometimes the oil cells like in a sebaceous cyst. So we can treat sebaceous cysts, but you know, I usually don't like doing those. I don't recommend. There's so many other problematic lesions, okay? And there's usually natural treatments for just about any of these besides what we're talking about, okay? Like the cysts, often you can smack them, the old Bible treatment, they'd smack a ganglionic cyst with a Bible and it involutes. It causes it to go away. So. Yeah, so it's okay, folks. Thanks for hanging out. We got a break. Yeah.